Morning, everybody. My name is Bjørn Håvard Stokke. I will take you through this presentation on HE remote power feed. HE remote power, what is it? It's power transmission over dedicated power cables, and we are using 400 volt DC as transmission voltage. Looking a bit on distributed power system, because it's a type of distributed power system, this concept. When you want to transmit power from site A to site B, or point A to point B, there are some limiting parameters. First, you have some sort of medium or a cable that you transmit the power in, and it has some resistance. Also need to drive some current through this cable to transmit the power, and these two will contribute to loss in the cable. The squared current times the resistance is simply energy burned or lost in the cable. Looking at the current, here it's a voltage and power relation. The larger power, the more current you need to drive through the cable. And but you can, if you have a higher voltage, the higher voltage you have, the less current. So voltage is good, power is bad. For resistance, it's based on two things. It's obviously the size of the cable, the cross section, the larger cable, the smaller resistance. And it's also length. Length is the longer you need to go, the more resistance. And the third thing is the resistivity of the cable. And I've taken some numbers here from Wikipedia. In this example, it's annealed copper and aluminium, which is the typical material used in the cables. Okay, then looking at the green, the good things, voltage, it's a limitation how high you can go, and it's both set by regulations and also the cost of protecting protection devices and the installation itself. When you look at the cross section, which is the other parameter you can increase to reduce the losses, it's basically the cost of cable. The copper price is sort of quite high, and yeah, that's one example. So given this, it's a practical limitation on the sort of power times length factor for a remote feed. So if you look at some examples of distributed power systems, and we have on the y-axis, we have this factor, which is power times distance, and the x is the voltage that you use. So in the low range, you have power over internet, and the latest standard is up to 100 watts, using about 54 volts. You have a 48 volt battery voltage, where you need to regard the disconnect voltage during discharge. You can have a DC-DC, just feeding 57.6 volt constantly, which means you have a higher voltage all the time. You have the old line power, the RFTV and RFTC standard, using traditional copper cables and plus minus 380 volts, 190 volts. Of course, you have normal AC. We have the 380 volt CPS, our data center, which is based on 380 volt float voltage. And also here, you need to regard the battery disconnect voltage in the low end. Then we have what we are discussing today, the remote power using 400 volt constant voltage. Then you have the big guys, which is the medium voltage and high voltage transmission systems for the grids. But the remote power is sort of in the middle here. This is where it fits. Okay, looking on the concept, basically the way it was derived is that there was some telecom companies having a normal telecom system, like telecom backup system in 48 volt DC as the main power. And in this concept, we stepped the 48 volt up to 400 volt DC, which is regarding regulation on low voltage DC, even though we are used to 48 volts, so we have called it high voltage DC. It's actually well within the voltage DC when it comes to regulations. Then we send the power through a dedicated remote feed power cable using 400 volt DC. And at the remote site, we step it down again to 48 volt to power the telecom equipment. This is the basic concept, and we'll take you through some more details now. Okay, quickly look a bit on the building blocks, just to show you what we are using. To do the step up to 400 volt, we have a flatback to DC-DC converter. And this can be powered both from 48 volt system and 60 volt battery systems. So it's a 42 to 75 volt input range. It's 1350 watts nominal full power, but it can do power boost for 2250 watt for up to 15 seconds. And this helps clearing faults if there is a short circuit on your feed. And it also has this extra safety feature that if it's unable to clear a fault and the voltage falls below 300 volt, it will shut down. The 5 seconds we will touch upon a bit later. This one also has an alarm relay, so we don't need the CAN bus if you don't want to look at the output power monitoring. Then there is a small teaser also. We are going to launch a 3U building block in Q1, which will be a 9450 watt or 25 amp output solution. And it will also include our fault monitoring and output breaker. More information about that later. I can't reveal more at this stage. In the other end, that means stepping down from 400 volt to 48 volt, we have a converter in the flatback S family, which is 750 watt output power maximum. It's a quite wide input range from 200 to 400 volt, and it will start derating below 300 volt. And that's the importance about this is to have a very low maximum input current, which means you can have a low input fuse for this unit at the remote site, and that is helping to achieve selectivity between your remote feed protection device at the central office and these input breakers at the remote sites. This one also has an alarm relay. If you don't want to use a controller, you can still get module alarm. And then another teaser for this one. Here we also plan to release a 3U building block, and that's including SPD, a class 2 SPD, and also individual breakers per for each module. We will also look about the importance of individual breaker soon. We also have a step-down converter in the Chameleon family. This one is 650 watts. It's IP65, so it's ideal for remote site applications where you don't have a cabinet, because the flatback S module that needs to be in an indoor type of environment. So if it's outside, you need a cabinet for it. So this will give you 650 watt up to 55 degree ambient. And beside that, it has the same specification as the flatback S. The only difference is that it also has a class 2 range, SPD included. If the environment is not above class 2, it's enough if it's a class 1 environment on the remote feed, then obviously you need a class 1 SPD device also. It's IP65, so it can be outside. You don't need to change the filters and these things. So it has good benefits for this application. We also have a 36-volt module, not very common in Fortelecom, but mention it anyway. It will produce 33 to 45-volt output voltage, but it's mainly used in industrial. Okay, so let's look a bit on technical and safety requirements. So the remote feed is 400 volt DC, as mentioned. So it's well within the low voltage regulations. It's also a floating or IT system. It's not grounded, and it has some benefits. The safety requirements is sort of set forth in this IEC or harmonized standard, the 60364-4-41, which is low voltage electrical insulation, and the part is for protection for safety, protection against electric shock. That's the main safety standard that needs to be covered. In the rollout so far, Eltek has not been the owner of the installation or installed the cable itself. So this is a customer which is responsible for this is fulfilled together with the installation company. It's good to give some guidance on how we interpret this standard and what is required. Okay, first thing is clearing a short circuit on your feed. So if this is your central office and you have some DC-DC modules stepping to 400 volt DC, then you obviously need some breaker here to cut the feed if there is a short circuit. Unless there will be a fire somewhere. You need to consider the worst possible case, and that is when the short circuit is in the far end of your remote feed cable. Then you need to make sure that it is sufficient current through this protective breaker to open it. It's two limiting factors. One is the short circuit capacity or overload current capability of the DC-DC converters. Secondly, it's the loop resistance in the cable. Here you can apply 400 volts, and for a long cable, the cable itself will actually limit. Even if you do a very hard connection here, you only get maybe 100 amp, 200 under them. So these two things must be considered. Looking a bit more into this, when we connect a device on the remote site, you can do a direct connection if it's not required to do any disconnect on the remote site. You don't need a switch there. You cut the feed here before you do work on the remote site. You can, of course, add a breaker for a disconnection here. If you have multiple units, it's important to note that with this configuration without any breakers, you don't have any redundancy. And that's because this central office breaker is very quick. And the power modules we have, they use glass fuses, which is very slow. So if there is a failure here, this breaker will always open first. Again, you can add a single breaker, but then you have the same scenario between the glass fuses in the module and the remote side breaker, input breaker. So still no redundancy. However, if you do like this with the individual breaker for each power module, then you have redundancy of the power modules on the remote site. Okay, then we will look a bit on earthing systems for the remote feed and the central office and the remote sites. And this has to do with earth fault, which we'll touch upon the next slides. All our system needs local grounding or chassis. That's required to meet the safety specifications. So you'll have local earth on both sides. And there is a certain connectivity via the soil earth, but we don't know for sure the impedance of this connectivity between the earths. So if you do like this, then it's regarding, as far as we read the standard, you have an individual earthing system. You have one for remote site and one for central office site. And this will set some differences in disconnection times during failure. If you, however, add a shielding or a ground cable in your remote feed, then you know the impedance from ground here to ground there. And then it's regarding a common earthing system. So that's the two types. So if you look on first earth fault, potential first earth fault, for instance, you have from the negative leg to earth on the remote site. For this type of systems, you are required an IT system, and for remote DC, you are required to have an insulation monitoring device. This should indicate the first occurrence of a fault. So you have a red alarm here. Since the power source is floating here, the potential fault current is low. So according to the standard, you don't have to turn off your feed. It can remain on since it's on, since you have this this system this situation, low fault current. Then, if you have a secondary fault in the systems. And this is now shown in the worst case scenario. This is having a earth fault positive, very close to the central office site. And you already have an existing from negative to earth. The standard says that you must disconnect within 5 seconds in a common earthed system. So I tried to visualize the worst case scenario here, where the current goes all this way. And the breaker should
then open within 5 seconds. If, and this was for a distribution circuit, if it's a fault in the final circuitry, which would be the system or the module itself, then it's 400 milliseconds, which is the requirement. In either case, in this setup, the current will go through both poles of the protective breaker. And this is quite important because the breaker manufacturers, they don't certify opening 400 volt DC over a single pole. So it's important that the current will go through both poles. Okay, so let's look about this distributed or separate grounding systems. We have one ground system here and one there, and no connection. And clearing a second earth fault, actually it's 1 second, because it's now regarded a terra-terra system and not IT anymore. Or it's actually an IT system, but for clearing the second earth fault, you have the same requirements as a terra-terra or TT system. The problem with the loop is now going through the soil, which we don't know the impedance, so we don't know the resistance. We don't know if there will be enough current to open this breaker. And for a final circuit, it gets even worse because we need to disconnect in a much quicker time, 200 milliseconds. So since it's not possible to guarantee that you will have the required disconnect time, it's not recommended with individual grounding. Okay, now another alternative here is that when you have sites on the same remote feed, you have a first site and then you're tapping off the remote feed, and then you more cable going to the next remote site. How does the second earth fault requirement look here? Again, same situation from positive to ground in the circular office, and from minus to negative to ground on the remote site at the far end. You still have the same requirements when it comes to clearing in within 5 seconds. The only difference is that you will probably have a longer cable, and still have the same requirement for 400 milliseconds for a final circuit. However, you have the same situation here. So current goes through both poles, so you can still use the two-pole breakers. So it's basically similar to a single site. So it's an okay topology to use. Then looking at multiple feeds. So here you have one DC-DC output. This is one galvanic isolated output. It's just one 400 volt DC here. And then you have two breakers. One is controlling this feed, and the other one is controlling a different feed. Now, clearing the second earth fault here gets more difficult. Because the current can potentially take one pole here in the positive leg, and then go to a short circuit here, and back and forth, and then it will return in one pole of the other branch. And in this case, the requirements for the breaker manufacturer is not met, because here it's only over a single pole. So actually they say that in this case you need two serial poles and a four pole breaker for each feed. In addition to this, of course, it's a possible travel for the fault current, which means it will take down the distance you can go. To sum up the technical requirements and the possible layouts of your system. So you can have a point to point where you have one DC-DC group feeding one remote feed through one breaker and having one remote site. That's fine. And it's very suitable and convenient when the remote power requirement matches well with the central office building blocks. That means that the central office building block is 1350 watts. And if you have something similar or matches well with that, that's good. If you have very small remote sites, then it can be beneficial to have several remote sites connected to the same feed, as we saw was okay. And then the central office infrastructure costs, they will be shared by several remote sites. And this last part, where you feed through several, where you have one DC-DC group feeding several remote feeds with their individual breaker. And these feeds have one or several remote sites. It can be wise for cost, etc. shared, but we have a problem with this clearing the second earth fault. So it's a bit not recommended or a bit more difficult to do. Okay, we will now look a bit on some application examples before we move on to the Q&A session. This is an ongoing rollout for DSLAM via the ESL application. It's actually the project that kicked off the development project for making these building blocks, the modules. And this it's a DSLAM or a VDSL in a very dense populated area. And they see that they need it's designed for up to 1,000 watts, but typical is 400 to 600 watt, 48 volt power required at these switching, small switching sites. And it was also designed that you could do up to 5 sites was the design goal. On the same feed and total distance up to 5 kilometers. So what is made for this is a central office cabinet where you have 4 modules, DC-DC modules, feeding one output. There's a 10 amp breaker that the modules, if you have 2 modules, they are able to open this breaker. And you have some SPD protecting the output of these modules and also the insulation monitoring or earth fault detection for each feed. And we have made 5 and 10 remote feed cabinets that the customer selects based on the size of or potential remote feed of his existing telecom sites. And in the remote end, it's basically a connection box where you do the daisy chaining, where you tap off from the remote feed, including SPD and the breaker, and you have space for 2 flatback S modules. And here you have selectivity between 10 amp in the remote in the central office and the 6 amp in the remote site, which means if you have a failure on one site, you don't kill the complete feed. So this was early 2014. We did the trial and pilot, and the rollout started in 2014. And so far, it's more than 3,000 remote feeds installed, and the remote site location is more than 20,000. So it's quite huge, this project. We also have another ongoing rollout, and that's remote radio units on rooftops. We have 6 RIUs of 500 watt per sector, so that's 3 kilowatt at full power. If all tech bands are on full power on the radios, worst case. So the challenge share for the operator is to that it's an increased power demand, and also the requirement is 2 or 4 hours backup, and this power demand is on the rooftop where the customer don't have a system today. So the possible solutions is to add a new battery system on the rooftop, and that's problematic due to the weight on the roof, as well as installation and cost of this more OPEX related things. You could pull new 48 volt cables. That means one 10 square mil cable, or maybe 16 square mil cable, to each RU. Or he could step up the voltage to 48 volt from or to 400 volt on new or actually existing 48 volt cables that has a 500 volt rating. So the customer here chooses to go for a 400 volt DC solution. Below 48 volt, then or 60 meter distance, then he would go for 48 volt if there is space for new cables. But in some places, it's not space to pull new 48 volt cables, and then you choose 400 volt DC. More than 60 volt, 60 meter distance, then it's this 400 volt DC remote power in general. And even if it's beyond the 137 meter, which is the maximum distance for 48 volt today, they always consider a 400 volt DC remote feed before adding a new local power system. And this also started in our rollout started in July, a bit smaller application list, but 630 central office and about 500 remote sites so far. No downtime, no failures, so the customer is very happy with the solution. And the feedback is faster and simpler installation. You have less space and weight in the RRU location, the remote site, and you have a centralized or fewer batteries, which is easier to both maintain and also to actually check that you have the required backup time during the lifetime of the equipment. Okay, so 5G. Here we have some nice animation. So can we use remote power for 5G? That's the question. We think so. If you look at this example where you have some a main telecom site with mains connection, and you have some remote sites or need for power, small cells around for 5G. We think that the operator has some headaches, and one is the cost of getting mains connection here and there, and also the tariff for these small low kilowatt hour connections, and also the number of location if they need backup time and you have batteries all over the place. So with remote feed, you can reduce the remote site footprint, weight, and also installation cost. And you don't have these OPEX things as batteries and maybe not filters, as well as tariff. So looking at this point-to-point thing in a more block schematic way, so we have the new small cell site with a 48-volt load. As you've been through, step it up to 400 volt, and then you might need SPD, might need MCB, don't know. So at least you have a power module, taking it down again to 48 volt. Could be that you need more to in parallel to feed this load. Could also be that the loads can be separated, so you can have one base station here, for instance, and one RU here, and then it's maybe just as good to do like this. It's typically some redundancy in the telecom equipment anyway. If you lose one RU, that's not that big problem. Some maybe it's okay without redundancy in the power module at the power module level. At least we see that with some operators. It could also be that you have more something with a cabinet and where the flatback S is suitable. Also here you need double MCBs for redundancy. And also as we discussed, it's having the four pole situation, four pole breaker situation, clearing the second fault. It's highly recommended that you have one DC-DC stage in front of each breaker and feed. That means also if you have a air fault in this section, it will not propagate to the other feed as well. A quick example, if you have around or 1950 volt here, with 2.5 square mile cable, you can go up to 750 meter with 400 volt DC remote feed. And for 1.5 square mile cable, it's 450. Again, smaller load, 1500 volt, you can go up to 1 kilometer. That's the maximum distance for this cable. You might want to have a higher cable for high efficiency. That's up to the application to decide. Okay, just a few more slides and we're done. This other example is where you have a chain of sites. So you have the central office or feeding point here, and you have maybe some on a line. It could be along a road, as we see here, or some a rail or something like that, or smart light poles with 5G for autonomous cars, or the DSLAM, which we already have seen roll out to. In this case, the remote site shared the central office infrastructure, as well as the remote feed cable. So it can be a lower capex compared to point to point. So in this section, just took the chameleon here, if a light pole example. And you pull the cable and you tap off along the way. And in this example, if you have 650 watt load at each site, you can have, with 4 square mile cable, you can have 430 meters between each pole for these four sites shown here. If you go to 6 square mile, then you can do 640 meters. Okay, that's basically all from my side.
Thank you very much, Bjørn. Now we have got some time for some questions, if our audience has any. And Ahmed, you have a question. Can we transmit on a Cat 5 cable?
No, it's designed to do that. It's several reasons. One is the it must make sure the cable is has 500 volt rating. I'm not sure about the Cat 5, but that's what is used for this old remote power concept, the 6950-21, the RFTV-RFTC, where you have the A limiter on in the central office that prevents you from doing overcurrent. And in this type, we only have 100 watt per channel. And we don't have these kind of precaution on the output on the central office. So in this application, you use a dedicated power cable. And we recommend you have at least a pull the ground wire, as discussed, or a shielder cable. The ones being deployed for the DSLAM is a ground cable with included shield. So this is this type of cables that we recommend and we see. And also we don't see it for You see it for a little larger power and distance factor compared to the RFTV, RFTC technology. And then you need some more, you usually need some more copper than you will have in a Cat 5 cable.
Can you please share the presentation? I don't see any harm in that, Bjørn.
Yeah, we can
make a PDF of it that we can share. Yep.
Good. So we will share the link to the video. We will share the presentation. Where has this been deployed?
We can say in Central Europe for the DSLAM, because this customer is under NDA and doesn't want us to use his name. The other one is Telenor here in Norway for the RRUs.
Great. And are there any lessons learned from this project?
Not really. On our side, it's basically for these customers. They have calculated the load and found the distance, and this matches well. It's been a lot of other applications where this must fit well, but when you look at it, it's either too long or even too short or too much power or. So it's in the rollouts, it hasn't really been any issues or lessons learned or something we needed to change. The installation companies have been very happy with this solution here in Norway, at least. So it's more where it has fit, it fits, and it's more if you want to do very much more power, then you see that, okay, maybe it will be too big cable, so other options is the alternative. I would say that's the only issue seen.
Great. So a question from Nick. What is the typical volt drop percentage on a 400 volt line for a single chameleon at a max loading of 650
watt? Well, in the examples shown, it's calculated maximum distance, and that means it's made sure that the breaker will open. That means that the cable will allow enough current. I don't remember the voltage drop in these examples, but we make sure that it's not within the derating area of the module, so it can be down. It can be a drop down to 80 volt, down to 320 is no problem for the module. But it's often the making sure you have enough capacity for short circuit that would set the minimum cable size, and then you can calculate the feed. Maybe it's worthwhile to go up one step on the cable and have a higher efficiency, and this should be considered the efficiency of the remote feed, including stepping up and stepping down. This is one part of the books you need to look at, and the other one is the fees for local AC.
A follow-up question from Nick. We have a restriction in South Africa standards of a maximum of 10% voltage drop. Would we then have a large max length limitation?
No, I don't think so. But it's basically using this. We have an Excel calculator that can be used as a baseline to calculate the feed, and it's no problem to make sure you are within this 10%. And so I will not say you have a large length limitation, but I think it's more you will have to invest mooring cables, maybe, if, compared to allowing for 20% drop. And when it comes to this voltage drop, it also gets more into the installation area and these requirements, and they have, if for instance, if you're going into a tight cable duct with many cables inside the building, maybe not 10% is allowed either. So when you get down to these details, you can calculate for 10 volt, but then you just need to start to work with your installation company and see what's the actual requirement for the installation.
Are we able to share the calculator we use for these calculations?
Yeah, I can share it with William, and then he can. You can contact him, and he can show you the tool a bit, because it's not 100% user friendly, but yeah.
Great questions. So at the moment, there are no more questions coming in. So I think we will conclude this webinar. Bjørn, thank you very much for your presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining. Have a great day. Goodbye.